بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This is a description for the data show of respiratory system. We all know that it is formed of two parts, conducting system or conducting part and respiratory part. The conducting part is for conduction of the air and the respiratory part is for gas exchange. The conducting part starts by the nose or the nasal cavity and the nasopharynx. After that, the nasopharynx here, nose, nasopharynx, and the larynx, the trachea, the bronchi, as well as the terminal bronchioles. The terminal bronchioles, these are present before the respiratory bronchioles. These are responsible for conduction and conditioning of the air. While the gas exchange takes place starting from the respiratory bronchiole, starting from the respiratory bronchiole, alveolar duct, alveolar sac, and finally the alveoli. This is a low power for the structure of the trachea, which is one of the conducting portion. It shows the four layers of the trachea. After the lumen, we have first the mucosa. And then after the mucosa, we can see the submucosa where glands are present. And then we have the fibrocartilaginous coat formed of hyaline cartilage, but it is incomplete posteriorly. And this area is occupied by the trachealis smooth muscle. The trachealis smooth muscle is responsible for constriction of the lumen to increase the force of airflow, and this takes place during coughing and any forced expiration. And finally, we have the adventitia, which is a loose connective tissue, as you see. This is the structure of the mucosa of the trachea, where we can find the lining, epithelial lining, which is pseudostratified columnar ciliated with goblet cell, the respiratory epithelium, and it is resting on connective tissue called lamina propria, so this is the mucosa. With the appearance of this connective tissue containing the glands, this is the submucosa. So the submucosa characterized by having the glands, mucocerous tracheal glands. Then we have the fibrocartilaginous coat covered by here a capsule, and it is a typical hyaline cartilage. This is a high power picture for the respiratory epithelium lining the trachea, which is pseudo stratified columnar ciliated with goblet cells, resting on connective tissue called lamina propria. You may see here elastic membrane formed of elastic fibers. So these are the three components forming the mucosa of the trachea. So the components are the epithelium, which is respiratory epithelium, and this is the lamina propria, and this is the elastic membrane. This is high power demonstration for the respiratory epithelium, demonstrating the following cells. This cell, which is very tall, has an upper end wider than the lower end or the basal part. This is the tall columnar cell. This is the ciliated columnar cell, which is provided by cilia. So these are the cilia. And this type is the most abundant, number one. It is most abundant, this type, which is the ciliated columnar cells. It is the most abundant. And each cell has about 300 motile cilia at the apex. And by the EM, you can see, that the apical part has numerous mitochondria, of course, to give the energy for the movement of the cilia. And together, the apical part contains also basal bodies. Basal bodies, which is a constituent for the cilia. Then you can see this goblet cell. This goblet cell, which has an upper expanded part and lower cylindrical part, is the goblet cell, or the mucous goblet cell. This cell is the next common, and the apical part is filled with mucin. As you see here, these are the mucin globules that dissolve during preparation of the section. And of course, its function is to give the mucus that covers this surface, and it traps bacteria and dust particles to be expelled to the outside by the movement of the cilia. Now, if you are asked, suggest what is the possible organelle that it is well developed in this cell, of course you will say that it is the Golgi apparatus, because the mucus is glycoprotein, so it has a well-developed Golgi apparatus. Also, we have a third type, so this is the first type, and this is the second type here, the goblet cell. Also in the picture, you can see here the connective tissue, lamina propria, under this epithelium. This is the connective tissue, lamina propria. Don't forget that in the smokers, the ratio between the goblet cell and the columnar, ciliated columnar cells here, this ratio, as you see, this is the columnar ciliated, most abundant than the goblet cell. This ratio is inverted, so that the goblet cells increase more than the columnar ciliated cell. And this, of course, to help the removal of the carbon dioxide. But at the same time, the movement of the cilia is decreased so that the mucus will accumulate. And since it is a nutritive material at the same time for bacteria, the bacteria will lead to inflammation of these passages. And this inflammation will lead to congestion of the smaller airways. This is another demonstration for the two cells in the respiratory epithelium, the most common, which is the columnar ciliated cells, provided with about 300 motile cilia. And in the apex, you should expect to have basal bodies and mitochondria. And the nucleus is present in the upper distended part of the cell. So this is nucleus in the higher level in this epithelium. Another type is the goblet cell, which has an upper expanded part and lower cylindrical part. This lower cylindrical part contains the nucleus, and the upper expanded part contains the mucin granules here, which are glycoprotein. And this cell, it is the next common in the respiratory epithelium. This is a diagram to demonstrate the bronchial tree. The bronchial tree, starting by the branching of the trachea into the two primary bronchi outside the lung. And inside the lung, we will have the secondary bronchi as well as tertiary bronchi. Then we have the bronchioles, and the most distal one is called the terminal bronchiole. And by the terminal bronchiole, we have ended the conducting portion, responsible for conduction and conditioning. Here we will start by the respiratory portion, where we have the respiratory bronchiole, characterized by the presence of alveoli opening on the wall of this bronchiole. Then we have a duct. This duct is characterized by having all of the wall is opened by the presence of alveoli. So it is called alveolar duct. It's just a duct here, which has alveoli all over the wall opening inside it. And finally, we will have a sac. A sac is more rounded space opening on which we have a lot of alveoli opening in this sac. And finally, we have the alveoli itself. So we have here the extrapulmonary or the primary bronchus. This is the extrapulmonary before entering the lung, and it is called primary bronchus. And then after entering the lung, it is called intrapulmonary or a secondary. Here the lung, So this is the secondary. These are the secondary bronchi. And by further branching, we have also tertiary bronchi. Then we have the bronchioles. And at the final part of these bronchioles, we have the terminal bronchioles. These are the terminal bronchioles. So we have a bronchiole. And we have, after further branching, we have the terminal bronchiole. And then, by this, we have finished the conducting portion. Then we have the respiratory portion, which is starting by the respiratory bronchiole. And then we have the alveolar duct, alveolar sac, and finally the alveoli. This is a picture for the intrapulmonary bronchus, which is the secondary bronchus. And you can know that it is different from the primary in its structure. First, the lining epithelium is the same type of epithelium as the primary, which is pseudostratified columnar ciliated with goblet cells, but the goblet cells here are less, these empty spaces. Also, the mucosa is formed of this epithelium and the connective tissue chorea, but the elastic membrane here is absent. Also, we have, in relation to the connective tissue chorea, we have this aggregation of lymphocytes called what? Called mucosa-associated lymphatic tissue. Don't forget that we have in the GIT, we have GALT, which is the gut-associated lymphatic tissue. This is the MALT, or the mucosa-associated lymphatic tissue. Here also, we don't have at all a submucosa. Here, the submucosa is completely absent. After the mucosa, we have immediately musculosa, but not evident in the picture. And then we have the cartilage. In the adventitia, in this layer is the adventitia. So we have the mucosa, musculosa not evident in this picture. It is formed of, here you can see some fibers. These are the spirally arranged smooth muscle fibers, not evident clearly. And then we have adventitia. In the adventitia, we have the hyaline cartilage plates. This is a plate here, not a C shape. And also we should have the glands, but not evident. Mucocerous glands and lymphatic nodules are not evident here in this picture. Here you can see some lymphatic aggregation here, also reaching the adventitia. This is the terminal bronchiole, which is the smallest and the terminal part of the conducting part, or the conducting portion. Here we have the extreme folding of the mucosa, and the epithelium, as you see, it is cubical simple, cubical cells with cilia. Here you can see the cilia, and also we have clara cells in between these simple cubical epithelia. Here we have a muscle layer, well evident compared to the previous picture of the intrapulmonary bronchus. Here the smooth muscles are circularly arranged. Their contraction controls the flow of the air to the sites of the gas exchange, because it is the terminal part in the conducting portion. So finally, don't forget, it is lined by simple cubical ciliated with clara cells. So the clara cells always are present in the bronchioles. So the lining of the terminal bronchiole is similar to any typical bronchiole in that it contains clara cells. But the type of the epithelium here is simple cubical ciliated epithelium. Now, if you are asked what is the lining of the bronchioles before this terminal bronchiole, the bronchioles wider than the terminal bronchiole are lined by simple columnar ciliated with clara cells. Of course, this is the connective tissue, outer connective tissue layer here. And notice that this connective tissue does not contain cartilage, does not contain glands, does not contain lymphatic nodules, characteristic for the intrapulmonary bronchus or the secondary and tertiary bronchi. Don't forget also that in the bronchial asthma, there is a severe contraction of these smooth muscles, spasm, and this is causing this constriction of the bronchioles and difficulty during expiration. So to relieve these symptoms, the patient will take sympathomimetic drugs to cause relaxation of the muscle. This is a picture also for the lung alveoli, blood vessels inside the lung tissue, and this air passage is of course a bronchiole because it does not show the cartilage. Also, it demonstrates the smooth muscle layer circularly arranged around this air passage, so this is a bronchiole. This is a picture for the terminal bronchiole. First, it is not a bronchus because we don't have cartilage, we don't have glands, we don't have lymphoid follicles. Then, it is a terminal bronchiole and not the first part of the bronchial tree because of two things. Here we have the lining. The lining is formed of simple cubical epithelium, together with the clara cells. But the bronchioles at the start are lined by simple columnar with clara cells. The second difference is the smooth muscles. The smooth muscles here are formed of one or two layers maximally. But the bronchioles at the start are surrounded by more thicker muscle, smooth muscle layer. Here, these are the clara cells, which are dome-shaped and projecting on the surface. And these are the simple cubical, which are ciliated simple cubical cells. And as you see, the height of the cells decrease as we go downwards. Also, it is not a respiratory bronchiole because we don't have alveoli opening in the wall. So it is a terminal bronchiole. This is the picture for important cell, which is the clara cell, which is present only in the bronchioles. It has a characteristic dome shape and it is projecting on the surface. And it is provided with granules in the top of the cytoplasm. So these all these cells with granules at the apex and dome shape, they are the clara cells and they are not ciliated. The function of these cells are very important and you may be asked about these functions. These functions are actually, number one is the protection of this epithelium through secretion of the mucin or the glycoprotein that will support this epithelium, and it is present in the secretory granules. Number two, it detoxifies any toxins present in the inhaled air by the help of the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, which is always present in the top of the cell. Number three, so we have here detoxification by the smooth endoplasmic reticulum present at the apex of the cell. Number three, the production of surfactant-like material. And this material will help to prevent the collapse of the bronchioles and not the alveoli. This material prevents the collapse of the bronchiole. It is a surfactant-like material. So we have this material, which is surfactant-like material that reduces surface tension in the bronchioles. Number four, here, it is also responsible for the protection against emphysema. Why? Because it inhibits the proteases and more specifically elastase enzyme that is produced by some of the microorganisms and destroy the wall of the alveoli by destroying the elastic fiber. So it protects against emphysema. How? By secretion of material that inhibit the proteases that will destroy the elastic fibers in the wall of the alveoli, preventing the alveoli from the collapse, and this will lead to the emphysema. Number five, here, it may act as a stem cell for the other cells present in the bronchioles. We have the columnar or the tubercle. We have also little numbers, especially in the start of the bronchioles, and then will disappear, little numbers of the brush cells and the small granule cells or the dense cells. Then you may be asked about the electron microscopic picture. What do you expect to have here? I should expect to have a well-developed smooth endoplasmic reticulum and also a well-developed rough endoplasmic reticulum together with the Golgi apparatus and mitochondria. Of course, don't forget that we have the secretory vesicles at the apex of the cells, which appear electron dense, in addition also to the presence of the apical smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So the smooth is in the apex, while the rough endoplasmic reticulum is present in the base of the cell. To summarize, we have this picture. First, here, we have this cell, dome-shaped, with the presence of the rough at the base, the smooth at the apex, and the secretory granules, which are electron-dense, the Golgi apparatus around the nucleus, and of course we have the mitochondria. This is the EM picture of the Clara cells. This is a diagram to show the respiratory portion, which is formed of the respiratory bronchiole, on which some alveoli open, and the alveolar duct, on which the alveoli are numerous opening in the wall, so that we don't have a definite wall. Its wall is formed of the wall of the alveoli. And then we have a common cavity, and not a duct, a common central cavity on which we have the alveoli opening, and finally we have the alveoli. Here is the respiratory bronchiole. The respiratory bronchiole is characterized by the presence of alveoli opening in it. Some of the alveoli are opening in the wall of this bronchiole. And since the gas exchange takes place in the alveoli, the respiratory bronchiole belongs to the respiratory portion. What else here? What else is different from the terminal bronchiole? The lining. The lining here is the same as simple cubicle ciliated with Clara cells, but the cilia will be lost in the distal portion. This is very important, together with the opening of the alveoli. But the most characteristic feature here is the opening of the alveoli in the wall. Here you can see the differences between the different parts of the respiratory portion. Here is the respiratory bronchiole. Why? Because I have a definite wall, but some of the alveoli are opening in this wall. And of course, you know, this is the most important feature to diagnose the respiratory bronchiole. The respiratory bronchiole is lined by simple cubical ciliated epithelium with Clara, but the cilia will be lost at the distal portions of these bronchioles. Like this, this is a distal portion because here we have the alveolar duct. What is the character that will help you to diagnose the alveolar duct is the presence of smooth muscles. at the opening of the alveoli. It has no wall but the alveolar duct. Its wall is formed of the simple squamous epithelium of the alveoli. And at the opening of the alveoli, we have smooth muscles. All these dots are representing the smooth muscle controlling the opening of the alveolus. So this is the alveolar duct. When we look here, this is no smooth muscles are present. So we have left the alveolar duct. And this is the alveolar sac, where the alveoli here are opening in one central cavity. So this is the alveolar sacs. Here, the alveolar sacs are all lined by the simple squamous epithelium, simple squamous alveolar epithelium, as well as the alveolar duct, because the alveolar duct is nothing but a pathway on which the alveoli are opening. But here we have smooth muscles, and in the sac we don't have smooth muscles. So the last part to show smooth muscle is the alveolar duct. Then we have, this is the alveolus. This is a single alveoli. This is a very nice picture to compare the terminal bronchiole from the respiratory bronchiole, from the alveolar duct and the alveolar sac. Look at the terminal bronchiole. The wall is not interrupted by alveoli. Of course, it is a bronchiole because we don't have cartilage, we don't have lymphoid follicles, we don't have glands. Then, at this area, we have an interruption in the wall by the opening of alveoli. So, this is a respiratory bronchiole, and this is also, there is an interruption by the opening of alveoli, but this is the wall itself, showing a smooth thin layer of smooth muscle, and the lining here is the same as the terminal bronchiole, except that in the distal part we don't have cilia on the simple cubical cells, but both have clara cells. Here, this is the respiratory with interruption of alveoli, and then when you look at this passage, you will see that it is nothing but alveoli opening on this duct. And you will notice the smooth muscles at the opening of the alveoli. So this is the alveolar duct. So these smooth muscles at the opening of the alveoli. Let us diagnose that it is the alveolar duct. It has no definite wall like the respiratory bronchiole. It is lined by the simple squamous epithelium of the alveoli with the presence of the smooth muscles here. But at this area, we have a cavity, and we have alveoli opening in this one central cavity with no smooth muscles. But here we have smooth muscles. So this is the alveolar sac, and this is the alveolar duct. And this is also an alveolar sac, no smooth muscles, but these are the alveoli. This is a picture for the alveolar duct and the alveoli. Here is an alveolus, another alveolus, but if you notice this thickening of acidophilic tissue, which is the smooth muscle at the opening of the alveoli, this is the alveolar duct. And this is an alveolus, and this is an alveolus, and here also it is an alveolus. These are the smooth muscles at the opening of the alveoli, so this is the alveolar duct. Its wall is formed of the wall of the alveoli, simple squamous epithelium. And there are smooth muscles, so it is an alveolar duct and not an alveolar sac. Here is the picture of the alveoli and the wall of the alveolus. The wall of the alveolus shows the lining cells, which is the pneumocyte type 1, representing the 97% of the alveolar surfaces, and these are flat squamous with flat nuclei. This is as regards the light microscope picture. But as regards the electron microscope picture, you can expect what? In this cell, we have few pinocytic vesicles. So if this is the pneumocyte type 1 and this is the nucleus, you will see pinocytic vesicles representing the engulfed particles in the form of fluids, of course, in this cell. as this cell will help in turnover of the pulmonary surfactant. يعني التجديد نشيل القديم ويتكون جديد and the removal of any small fluid particles in the alveolar space. So this is the pinocytic vesicles. More than that, you will have, of course, junctional complexes between the pneumocyte type 1 cells. What is the function of this cell? The function is the gas exchange because it is a very thin surface. So it allows the passage of the gases in and out of the alveoli. Here we have also the other cell here, which is pneumocyte type 2. What is the percentage? Its percentage is 3%. So this is 97% and this is 3%. And what is the LM picture? They are cuboidal cells. As you see, this is the cell, not flat squamous, they are cuboidal with the central rounded nuclei. And cytoplasm appear to be foamy, very important feature. Cubical, central rounded with cuboidal cells with central rounded nucleus and a foamy cytoplasm. As regards the electron microscopic picture, what you will expect. If you know that the function of this cell is the production of surfactant, which is formed of phospholipids with proteins and glycosaminoglycans, you can expect the following. First, the cell is the cuboidal, and it is provided with microvilli to increase surface area for the for the production or for the release of the secretory products, and it has the following. This is the nucleus, of course. It has rough endoplasmic reticulum to form the protein components present in the surfactant. Of course, you will have also the secretory of the rough, which is the Golgi apparatus, and also you will have mitochondria. So that these are important features. In addition, of course, they have smooth endoplasmic reticulum for the production of the phospholipids in the surfactant. Another important feature that I will draw in a different color is the presence of these structures called cytosomes. These cytosomes are multi-lamellar bodies, يعني فيها لاميلي كتيرة, multi-lamellar bodies. And they are called cyto, means cytoplasm, zomes means bodies, inside the cytoplasm. These contain the secretion produced by the cell, which is the surfactant. So these bodies contain phospholipids, proteins and glycosaminoglycans forming the structure of the surfactant. Here we also notice another cell present inside the space, alveolar space, and it may be present in the interalveolar septum. This is a blood inside a blood capillary, and this is a macrophage present inside the airspace. These macrophage are originating from blood monocyte. And the fate of these cells is that it may migrate to the bronchioles to be covered in the sputum, or it passes to the lymphatics to be drained out from the lung, or remain in the lung in the interalveolar septum. This is a high power picture for the alveoli. You can see here the pneumocyte type 1, flat cells with flat nuclei, and also pneumocyte type 2, cubical or cuboidal cell with central rounded nuclei and foamy cytoplasm. And these are the capillaries present in the interalveolar septum, and this is the alveolar space. This is a picture, of course, for the trachea. Identify the tissue in the center of the field. It is hyaline cartilage. Identify the layer by the arrow. It is the perichondrium. Identify the structure indicated by the arrow in 3. These are chondrocytes in lacunae. And if it is present here, it is the matrix. Number four, identify the tissue on the right. It is the epithelium, respiratory epithelium, pseudostratified columnar ciliated with goblet cell. Number one, identify this organ, trachea. Number two, identify the boxed structure. It is the epithelium between two brackets, pseudostratified columnar ciliated with goblet cells, and connective tissue chorea. Number three, red arrow points to hyaline cartilage. Identify the organ, lung. Identify the entire structure that fills the field, bronchiole. Identify the tissue indicated by the arrow, smooth muscles. If you are asked about its direction of its arrangement, it is circularly arranged. Number four, identify the tissue indicated by the arrow. It is the epithelium between two brackets, simple columnar ciliated with clara cell. Identify the organ, lung. Identify the space indicated by the arrow. This is, of course, the alveolar sac, as we have multiple alveoli opening in one central space. Number three, identify the space indicated by the asterisk. These spaces are the alveoli. Number four, identify the structure indicated by the arrow. It is the interalveolar septum. Identify the organ. This is the lung as a whole. Identify the entire structure indicated by the arrow in number two. Number two, it is the smooth muscle. Number three, identify the structure indicated by the tip of the arrow. This is the epithelium, so it is pseudostratified columnar ciliated with less goblet cells as it is an intrapulmonary bronchus. Number four, identify the tissue indicated by the arrow. It is the plate of hyaline cartilage. I want to add here that you will notice these are the goblet cells. And I want also to notice that the smooth muscle does not form a continuous circle. It is interrupted. Why? Because it is spirally arranged. Black arrow points to, this is a pneumocyte type 1. Green arrow points to, this is a pneumocyte type 2. Green arrow. And red arrow points to, this is the blood capillary, as we see here, red blood cells. Blue arrow points to alveolar macrophage. If you are asked about this arrow, here it is an alveolar pore. So this is the alveolar phagocyte, the alveolar space, type 1, type 2, blood capillary. Identify this organ, lung. Identify one, this is a terminal bronchiole, no alveoli opening in the wall. Number two, I have some of the alveoli opening in the wall, and this is the respiratory bronchiole. Number three, we have a wall formed of alveoli, nothing but alveoli, so this is the alveolar duct. Number four, we have a wide space, common space in the center on which the alveoli are opening. This is the alveolar space or the alveolar sac. Identify the structure pointed to by black pointer. This is a bronchiole. Number two, identify the curved arrow and the star. The curved arrow is pointing to the epithelium of the bronchiole, which starts to be simple columnar ciliated with clara cells. And the star, this is an alveolar space here. If you have a label here, this is the smooth muscle. Why you have diagnosed it as a bronchiole? Because it is devoid of three structures, which are the cartilage, the glands, and the lymphoid follicles. This diagram to demonstrate the difference between the typical bronchiole and the respiratory bronchiole. The bronchiole at its start is lined by simple columnar ciliated with the Clara cells. But the respiratory bronchiole is interrupted by the opening of the alveoli, and it is lined by simple cubical ciliated with Clara cells like the terminal bronchiole, but the terminal bronchiole has no alveoli opening in the wall. And the distal part of the respiratory bronchiole, these cilia will disappear. Also, this diagram to demonstrate the changes that takes place in the epithelium, the goblet cells, the cilia, the glands, the cartilage, and the smooth muscle. First, as regards the epithelium, it starts to be pseudostratified columnar ciliated with goblet cells, and this is present in the trachea as well as in the extrapulmonary bronchus and intrapulmonary bronchus. While in the bronchiole, it is simple columnar ciliated with goblet with Clara cells. And then it changes in simple cubical ciliated epithelium with Clara cell in the terminal bronchiole as well as in the respiratory bronchiole. And at the distal part of the respiratory bronchiole, these cilia disappear. And then it becomes simple cubical non-ciliated with Clara cells. Then in the alveolar duct and the alveolar sac and alveoli, it is simple squamous epithelium. So this is the changes that takes place in the epithelium. As you see, the goblet cells are present in the trachea as well as the bronchi. The cilia disappear after some time. They are present till the respiratory bronchiole and disappear in the distal part of the respiratory bronchiole. As regards the glands, they are present in the trachea and extrapulmonary bronchus in the submucosa and the intrapulmonary bronchus in the connective tissue between the cartilage plates. As regards the cartilage, it is present in the form of C in the trachea and extrapulmonary bronchus, but in the form of plates in the intrapulmonary bronchus and then disappears completely. Then we have the smooth muscle. First, it is present between the two ends of the C-shaped cartilage in the trachea and extrapulmonary bronchus. Then it appears as few smooth muscle fibers here in the wall of the intrapulmonary bronchus. But they are spirally arranged. And then in the bronchioles, they are present as circularly arranged. And the last station to appear in the alveolar duct around the opening of the alveoli. And this is the last station you can see smooth muscles in it.